I said, has grace gotten you? You know, when you understand the dynamics of grace, you realize how unworthy you are of the presence of God, but nonetheless, because of his mercy and his grace, you are. Hallelujah. God's good. Amen. Just before I minister in the word, I just want to make you aware, we're going to have a very short meeting right after the morning message this morning. I just want to give you an update of where things are going, how we're proceeding, and the things that we've been talking about over these past months. So I just want to make you aware of that after the end of the service. Also, I want to thank you in your giving. The taxes are getting ready to come up at the end of this month. Just received the tax bill from the government. They always found a way, you know, they're not supposed to be able to tax the church, but nonetheless, they found a way a couple of years ago to impose upon us some kind of a situation. And so we've got to come up with, like, say, right around $1,600 in that ballpark range. And you've been getting there, you're getting about a third of the way there. So as you continue to give, just bless the Lord. Hopefully you've done that today. But we've got about two more weeks or so before we have to take care of that by the end of the month. So I thank you for what you're doing in that area of things, just for being that blessing. Amen. Also want to remind you, Men's Fellowship is not this coming Saturday, but the Saturday after. We'll be putting an insert in there, but you guys start to prepare for that. We're going to have a good time in the Lord. We'll be blessed by it. God will be glorified. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So I'm giving a shout of praise in the house this morning. Amen. God's good. Now you guys, listen. I expect your debit cards at the end of the service. PayPal's good too. You can do PayPal. It's all good. Okay, I know that. But this is for the kids. You take care of the kids. I went by to talk to the kids about giving. You know, their loose change and everything and their bills. They don't carry anything like that. I can't believe that. But they have debit cards that I discovered. But they wouldn't give me them either. I don't know what's going on, you know? I don't know. Parents are going to have a talk with your kids. Hallelujah. God's good. For the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about ministering in a thought process about living life in overflow. About living life in the reality of where God wants us to live on an ongoing basis. Ministered last week in a thought process about living life in the overflow. About the dynamics of what it takes to be able to live that way, because that truly is where God wants you and I to live all the time, in that overflow that he has for us. And so this morning I sort of want to add to that thought process another thought, and it's basically this. It's the goal of God's overflow, understanding the dynamics of what it takes for you to live your life in the overflow of God on an ongoing basis, because truly that is where God wants us to live our lives, because he's come that you and I, we might have life and have it more abundantly. I want to talk about that in just a few moments. But you see, that's where God wants to live, life in the overflow. He wants you to live your life on literally on fire for him. He wants you to be consumed, if you will, with the abundance of it. He started pouring himself out into the midst of the service here today, just touching hearts and lives in a mighty way. Why? Because, you know, he says in his word, as you draw close to him, he will draw close to you. And so when you have started reaching out over these past weeks, especially drawing close to the Lord starts showing up in a mighty way. It's not all about a shout. It's not all about having a good time. It's not anything about that, even though those things take place. It's all about really living your life in the overflow of God, the place where God himself lives. And I want to talk some about that this morning and some of the thought process. But here's the reality. God wants to set your life ablaze. Period, end of sentence. He wants to open up the floodgates of the power of his glory, of his Holy Spirit, in such a measure that he can flow through you, he can flow in you, he can accomplish what it is he wants to, so that you will literally be the living fulfillment, if you will, of the latter day outpouring that the prophet Joel spoke about in Joel 2:28-29, where he said in Joel, these words, he said, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. I'm here to tell you this morning, And God wants to pour his spirit out upon your heart, upon your life, in a mighty way, in such a measure, in such a way that your life will never, ever, ever be the same again. Let me encourage you. If you haven't been baptized in the Holy Ghost, or it's been a while since the Holy Spirit has been able to live in you and through you in the measure that he wants to, I'm here to tell you today, you need to press in. You need to allow God to overtake your heart and life, because it's not about speaking in tongues. It's not about shouting. It's not about any of those things. It's about the reality of God taking up residence inside of you in such a measure that he can live through you, accomplishing what he wants to, because he didn't save you just to save you. He saved you to use you for the work of his kingdom, that in the midst of who you are, as when people start to see you, who they end up seeing is not you, they see him. Because I'm mindful, and you've heard me say this many times over the past years, the reality is if somebody can see Jesus inside of you, it will change their life. It'll transform them from the inside out. So what has to happen is they have to see Jesus inside of us. So God wants to pour his spirit out upon all flesh. And he says, your sons and your daughters, they shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also on my manservants and maidservants, I will get it right. I will pour out my spirit in those days. And in the day that we're living and we're seeing that greater outpouring of God by his spirit in the midst of all that he wants to do, because God wants to glorify himself. He wants you and I to live in the reality of what we started talking about, the overflow of God and what he wants to accomplish in hearts and lives. See, I don't want to seem redundant over some of the scriptures that I shared with you last week, but as I was meditating upon this week and really pressing in about what God would have me do, I realized that in the midst of preparing for today's message, that literally I need to bring back into our spirit some of the things that God spoken to us last week, afresh and anew. Because listen, in the midst of all that's going on, that you and I, we need to get into the flow of this Holy Spirit and allow God to touch our hearts and lives and let the reality of scriptures overtake us in such a measure, in such a way that our lives are changed and transformed, that we become opened up to what it is God wants us to do, not only in inside of us, but what he wants to do, touching other hearts and lives. Because what God wants to do is use you as an instrument to accomplish the things for his kingdom. Amen. He wants to use you to, in such a measure, in such a way that not only are you changed, but everybody around you is changed in the midst of what God wants to do. So when you stop and you consider the reality of what God wants to do, we started talking about John 10:10. We have for the last couple of weeks, where the thief does not come but except to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And I started sharing about the reality of that abundant life, that out of the Amplified, what it says, so that you can live your life to the full till it is literally overflowing in the power and the anointing of God and all that God wants to do. Listen, God, as I said before, God didn't just save you to save you. He saved you to use you to be somebody that reflects Jesus Christ in everything you do in life. Amen. I mean, when you stop and you think that God chose you for that call, that's something that you should rejoice in and praise God in. Because why? God wants you to, oh yeah, give him praise. Because see, God wants to use us. And we discovered that when we started talking about John 7:38, where Jesus himself said, he who believes in me out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. I'm here to tell you, if you are saved today, that the only reason the rivers of living water aren't flowing through you is because you're stopping it up. Amen. But if you can get out of the way and let the Holy Spirit flow in you and through you and allow God to accomplish what he wants to, the rivers of living water will flow in you and flow through you, and God will touch hearts and lives. Why? Because as you look at Ezekiel 47:9, we talked about it last week, and it shall be that every living thing, wherever the river goes, it will live. I'm here to tell you that when the river of God cannot just get inside of you, but can start to flow outside of you, everyone you touch will become alive. God will use you as an instrument to touch hearts and lives. And he goes on and says, for they will be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes. I'm here to tell you today, God has called you to be an instrument that'll touch hearts and lives, that'll transform everybody you come in contact. Our youth, when you go to school, you touch lives and transform lives. God will empower you to do it. The rest of us, as we get out into the world where you work at, whatever it is you're doing, when you allow the living word, the Holy Spirit, to flow in you and flow through you and use you, man, you're going to change hearts and souls and lives. People are going to set on fire, and people are going to be saved for the kingdom of God. Amen. Somebody praise him. Why? Because he wants to use you to accomplish those very things. We know that it can be done. You might doubt your ability, but I'm here to tell you, when you look at Ezekiel 47 and 1 that we looked at also last week, it says, and where the river flows from up underneath the threshold of the temple, the water was flowing from under the right side of the temple, south of the altar. I'm here to tell you that you'll never do it on your own power, but on the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit and God living in you and living through you, you will accomplish great and wondrous things. All you got to do is get out of the way and let God be God. All you got to do is allow him to live inside of you and live through you and accomplish what it is he wants to. We discovered that, and then we went on and talked about out of 1 Corinthians 10:4 last week about the reality. And it says, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ Jesus. I'm here to tell you today, Jesus not only resides on the inside of you, he wants to reside on the outside of you. The Holy Spirit doesn't just reside on the inside. He wants to flow out through you. He wants to use you and cause everybody to drink of that spiritual rock. Amen. If you drunk of Jesus, you need to share him. I don't know about you, but I'm here to tell you that if you're thirsty, all you've got to do is drink of him, and God will transform everything that's going on. He'll use you for that very purpose. And then we tied it in with Jeremiah 2:13 about the reality that my people have forsaken me. And that isn't what I wanted to talk about. But who they forsook was the very one that you and I are talking about, the fountain of living waters. I'm here to tell you today that if you allow the Lord to not just get involved in who you are and what he wants to do, but you say like Isaiah said, here am I, Lord, send me. And you allow God to live in you and live through you. I'm here to tell you that you will change the world of everybody that you come in contact. You'll touch hearts and lives. And when you get to heaven, all of a sudden what you'll be able to do is lay at the Lord's feet all those that you were able to lead to the Lord. Oh, listen, we plant and we water. It's the Lord that gives the increase in everything that goes on in the kingdom of God. When you get out of the way and let God be God, God will change your heart, change your life, and use you for something special to accomplish the kingdom of God. Somebody give him praise. But you see, I want to talk to you this morning about the go of God's overflow. About some of the reality of what it is that you need to grasp a hold of today. Because you see, you may not see yourself the way the scriptures describe the reality of what will happen in us and how God will flow through us. You may not realize that God is your source of everything that goes on in life. But I'm here to tell you that when you see yourself that way and you start to live in God's overflow of life, things happen. You will literally become the fulfillment of Joel's prophecy in Joel 2, 28 through 29. And you will be part of what God uses to fulfill his healing prophecy of Joel 3, 18. When you look at Joel 3, 18, it says this, and it will come to pass in that day. I'm talking about, I believe, the day that you and I are living in. The day that the power of the Holy Spirit is flowing, as you see it in these latter days and the things that are going on. It says that a fountain shall flow from the house of the Lord. You're talking about God himself by his Spirit starting to accomplish inside of the hearts and lives of those that are willing and saying, here, Lord, here am I, send me. That when they're willing to get out of the way and let God be God, that he will come. He'll flow in them as the water of healing that will go into the valley Acacias. I love that word, to the valley of Acacias. Now that is a very special word that was used in the midst of that scripture. God could have used anything of the thought process, but when he used that word, it's something that truly is special that you and I need to understand this morning. Because it literally lays part of the foundation of what it is God wants to speak into your heart and your life today. Now that word in Hebrew of Acacias is about the acacia woods or the acacia trees. And in Hebrew that word is shittim. And it's a very special word because that word, when you understand the dynamics of it, what it's talking about is that when you look at the acacia tree and you look at the dynamics of what it is, what it's talking about is the branches itself. And the branches themselves are something that is used for scourging. They have thorns on them. It might have been the very part of the very framework of the crown of thorns that Jesus wore. I don't know that. I'm just taking that as a statement. But literally they would use that, the branches of that, because they have thorns on them to scourge people, to whip people, and get them in shape, to beat them because of the things that they've done wrong in life itself. Listen, when you and I start to recognize what he's saying here in this verse, that a fountain shall flow from the house of the Lord, and water of healing will go to the valley of Achaia, the place that where the scourging, the place of scourging, the place of beating, the place that you and I deserve, everything that we deserve in life, where God himself comes onto the scene and sets us free. When we recognize that God wants to use us as an instrument to set other people free, to where he can flow into their hearts and lives, and we allow God to do that inside of us, that changes the dynamics of life itself. When you realize that you are an instrument, that God wants to flow through, that he wants to bring healing to the hearts and lives of so many that deserve nothing but the wrath of God himself, just as you and I deserve. And we realize that he's called us to a place that we can be an instrument to touch hearts and lives. If I learn to get myself out of the way and allow God to live in me and live through me, it'll change the dynamics of everything that goes on in life. Because God himself is looking to and fro, he says, across all of creation, looking for somebody that is just willing to say, Lord, here am I, use me. And when I get to that place in my walk with God, that's when God, the fountain himself, will flow through me and will touch the hearts and lives and bring healing to others that deserve nothing but whippings and beatings and nothing but hell itself. The place that every one of us deserves. But listen, when we allow the river to start to flow in us, and we allow the river to start to flow through us, that's when God brings about the changes. He brings about the healing that people need. You were designed to be an instrument to bring healing to the hearts and lives of many. You were designed to be an instrument that God could use, that if you just allow God use you, that it'll touch so many people. Why? Because God says you're not going to do it on your own, but I have placed inside of you the ability, that living river of living water, to flow out of you to accomplish something great. All you've got to do is be willing to say, Lord, here am I. Send me. You see, for God's fountain to flow in you, and to flow through you, to be his healing to all of humanity, every person that you touch in life, there are two things that you have got to do. Two things that you've got to grasp a hold of for your own life to allow God to use you as that instrument. The first thing is simply this, is you've got to go with the flow. You've got to be willing to go with the flow. You must allow God to lead you in the direction that he knows best for you and your life. I've had to learn over the years that I thought I knew everything. I know none of you think that. None of us think that. We all don't know, you know, we think we know everything, but the reality is we don't. But in my life, I've discovered one thing, that if I allow God to lead and guide and direct me, that God himself knows best. And when I allow God to get in the way of my life and go with the flow that God wants to accomplish, that when I do that, that's when God sets into motion his plans and accomplishes great and wondrous things. And I tell you this morning that only when you go with God's flow do you accomplish his will, not only in your life, but in the hearts and the lives of everyone else. When you and I become the recipient of God's plan, as well as the instrument that he brings life into the hearts and lives of others, when you and I allow God to have his way, he accomplishes something great that truly touches hearts and lives and transforms everything. When you and I accomplish that and allow God to accomplish it inside of us, that's when God starts to accomplish great and wondrous things, and that's when God goes before us, glorifying his heart and his life all the more. You see, the key to living in God's overflow, God's place of healing, is simple. You've got to discover the reality of what we were talking about earlier about Ezekiel 47 and 9. I mean, when you take a look at that verse, and I just want to go back to it just for a second. And it says that it shall be that every living thing, wherever the river flow or goes, it will live. There's a dynamic in the midst of what God was saying through Ezekiel that most of us fail to grasp a hold of, but if we can grasp a hold of it and apply it into our hearts and lives, it changes everything that goes on in our lives. And all of a sudden, the power of God is flowing not only in us, but is flowing through us, accomplishing what God has set upon us and wants to do inside of our lives. Do you see it? And it says, it shall be that every living thing, wherever the river goes, it will live. Why? For they will be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes itself. What you and I fail to recognize and see most of the time is one very simple thought in the midst of what it is that God is saying to us through Ezekiel, that he's saying to you and he's saying to me today. See, if you want to go where the healing flow of God is going, so that it can impact you and touch the hearts and lives of everybody else, you've got to do one thing. One thing is required of every single one of us. Simply this: you've got to jump in. You yourself have got to make a determination that I'm going to literally get off of the bank of where the river is flowing. And I'm going to literally have to jump into the midst of what God wants to accomplish and do. I've got to make a determination that I'm going to get myself wet. Are you hearing me this morning? I've got to make a determination that I've got to have that made up mind that my life no longer is about me. My life is all about him. It's about allowing God to have his way. In other words, in the midst of that, I've got to be willing to go with the flow. I've got to be willing to go where God would have me to go, do what God would have me to do, accomplish what God would have me to accomplish, do what it is that he created my life for. When I grasp a hold of that, and I say to myself, like Isaiah did, here am I, Lord, send me. In other words, he was willing to jump in. When I'm willing to jump into the river and the flow of God's Spirit where he wants to go, he'll use you and me as an instrument to bring healing to multitudes. He'll use you and me to accomplish great feats for the kingdom of God. But what has to happen is God is looking for somebody who is willing to just jump in. My question is, are you willing to jump in? See, you've got to be willing to jump in. If you want God's benefits that Ezekiel says is yours, you literally got to jump into the midst of the river, the flow of God, and allow God to flow, not only flow in you, but to flow over you, and then flow through you, and touch everybody's hearts and lives. I've got a question for you this morning. Is there any jumpers out there this morning? Are you willing to jump? Are you willing to say, yes, Lord, use me to accomplish what it is you want? Because, see, until you get that way in your heart, until you get that way within your soul and your spirit, and that you're willing to allow God to use you to accomplish great things, you'll never truly fulfill the greatness of the call that God has on your life. But you've got to be willing to jump in. You've got to get out of the way and let God be God. Second thought is this, and it's going to be real fast. You not only have to go with the flow, you have to be willing to flow with the go. You can't just go with the flow. That's one aspect. The other dynamic is you've got to be willing to flow with the go. In other words, wherever God wants to go, you got to understand the reality is that you got to be willing to go with wherever God wants to go to accomplish whatever it is that God wants to accomplish. In other words, you got to be willing to yield to God and let God have his way within every aspect of life. It's one thing to raise up your hand and say, here am I, Lord, send me. And it's another thing to flow with the go. Are you hearing me this morning? And so the dynamics is that I've got to be willing to yield my life to God and let God have his way within the heart of my life. See, to live a life that walks in the wisdom of God's abundance, in other words, someone who is willing to yield to God, it requires living a life that flows with the go. In other words, a life that is willing to yield to God. I'm mindful of the book of James, James 3:17. It says this, it says, wisdom from above is first of all pure, it's peace-loving, it's gentle at all times, and it is willing to do one other thing. It's willing to yield to others. Until you're willing to yield to God, you can cry out to God all day long. Say, Lord, hear my, send me. And when God's calling, if you don't turn around and you don't go, then you're not willing to yield. The question is, are you willing to flow with the go as you are willing to go with the flow? You've got to be willing to flow with the go just as you're willing to go with the flow. So the reality of your life boils down to this, and I'm sort of closing on this thought. See, you've got to yield to the plan that God has for your life. Because your life and my life really boils down to this. The very same thing that it boiled down to Jesus when he walked on this earth. In the Garden of Gethsemane, his life pulled down to one thing. He was 33 years old, had lived 3 years of ministry, done all the different things that he had done. But his life boiled down to one thing. In the Garden of Gethsemane, saying this very, very statement, "Not my will, but your will be done." In other words, he was willing to get out of the way and yield his life to what God knew needed to be done. His flesh didn't want to yield to it, just as many times we don't want to. But I've learned one thing about through my life, and that's this, that when I finally get to the place that I'm willing to yield to God, I'm willing to flow with the go, in other words, do what it is that God wants done, that the moment that I do it, everything changes, and it always changes for the better, never for the worse. The power of God comes down, the power of Spirit of the Lord overtakes things, and when God's flowing in the midst of what he wants to do, he accomplishes the only things that he alone can do, and he uses you as the instrument to accomplish it. You not only have to go with the flow, but you're going to be willing to flow with the go. You got to be willing to yield to God's plan. You got to say, "Not my will, but thy will be done." And recognize that just as Jesus had to yield, so do you and I. Flowing with God's go, yielding to him, is God resuscitating us. It's giving you and me mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. It is him breathing life into you and me, as it was in the very beginning, which took what was lifeless and it caused it to come to life. It takes the fountain of God, the breath of God, the anointing and the power of God breathing upon us life to cause us to flow in the fullness of all that God has for our lives. So the question really boils down to this: am I willing to allow God to have his way? Am I willing to accomplish what it is that Isaiah 48:21 says? It says, "And they did not thirst," because of one reason. Israel didn't thirst out in the desert. It was because they did not thirst when God led them. In other words, they yielded to God. They said, "God, I'll go where you want to go." And they went where God wanted to go. When you allow God to have his way in the midst of what's going on, God changes everything. See, God's overflow of abundance in John 10:10 is God's flow of his exponential reality, living in the reality of your heart and your life. See, that's the realm where God himself lives, and that's where he wants to live inside of you and wants you to live inside of him. When you allow the reality of the exponential reality of God himself to overtake your heart and your life, all of a sudden no longer is it you doing anything, but it's God doing everything through you. I am mindful, and I've shared this before, about the reality of exponential, things being exponentially increased. The exponential increase of God is something that doubles continually in the midst of all that's going on. I mean, it's sort of like that illustration. I think I shared it a couple of times in the past, over the past years, just to get a point across. And it boils down to this. You could take a penny today, just one penny today, and tomorrow you double it. And you add the one penny to the other two pennies, you got three pennies. And the next day, you take the one penny and the two penny, and you double it, the two penny, and all of a sudden you add, well, you said four, you add four pennies to the two pennies and the one penny, and then you keep doing that every single day. That literally in the matter of 31 days, if you followed that principle of doubling everything, that penny, every single day and adding the rest of it to it, in the process of your life, you'd end up with $464,330. One penny multiplied exponentially is the way God works in his kingdom within our hearts and lives. If you just allow God to do what he wants to do. So my question to this in closing is simply this. You got to be willing to go with the flow of God. You got to go, you got to understand the go of God's overflow and allow God to live it in you and through you. And when you do, that's when God can accomplish something great. I'm going to ask you to stand with me this morning across the sanctuary. I want to ask you to recognize a simple reality that God saved you to use you. He saved you so you can go to heaven. There's no question about that. That's a blessing, beyond any blessing. But he also saved you so that you can touch others' lives, so other lives can come into the kingdom of God just like you're going to be able to. And so the bottom line of our lives boils down to this, is that the river of God, our fountain of life, is always, always flowing. God's always flowing, always doing something. He's just waiting for you and for me to jump in and go with his flow so that he can use us as his instruments, touch the hearts and lives of others, and affect their lives abundantly so that in the midst of it that he can flow with our going. And when we allow that to happen, he'll use us as an instrument to touch hearts and lives. So my question to us this morning is simple. Are you willing to allow God to take you? I don't care how young you are. It doesn't matter how old you are. All that matters is that you're willing. Are you willing to allow God to start to work in you and through you in such a measure, in such a way, that exponentially he can increase you? He can take one person. He can multiply you over and over and over and over and over and over again to where exponentially you, that one person, will become many people for the kingdom of God. All you need to do is allow God overflow to touch your life. Are you ready to jump in? Father, this morning, you know our hearts. And Lord, I may not have conveyed things well this morning, and I may not have accomplished all that I felt in my spirit that you placed upon me, but I know that you've spoken into the lives of your children. And I know, Lord, this morning that you're speaking to each and every one of us to have a willingness to allow you to cause us to not only jump in, but to cause us to flow where you, the river, are flowing. You are the fountain of life. You are the abundance of all that we are and will ever be. And you've called us, Lord, not only to salvation, but to be used as an instrument to touch the hearts and lives of many. If this morning you're willing to jump in, if you will, to allow the Lord to touch you, I'm going to ask you just to get up from where you are and just sort of come down across the front here this morning. Just as an act of jumping in, if you will. Now, if you don't feel that tug, don't get up from your seat. But if you do, what you're saying is, Lord, I'm ready to jump in. I'm ready to get wet for what you want to use me for. I'm willing to do what it is that you've called me to do so that I can be your instrument that'll glorify your name. Why don't you stretch your hands this way this morning, church? Lord, this morning, for these that are down here today, they realize the need to jump in. There's many in the auditorium, they've already jumped in. They're out there touching lives on an ongoing basis. And so, Lord, today I'm asking the Lord a fresh anointing will fall upon these that are here. That desire to move within the midst of who you are, to accomplish the things you want to accomplish, so that, Lord, that you'll be able to flow them in them and through them like the river that you are, that'll touch hearts and lives afresh and anew. Holy Spirit, we need you to touch us as only you can. Overshadow us and overtake us as only you are able to. And then start to accomplish within inside of us that we as your instruments will touch lives and touch lives abundantly just as you came to do in John 10:10. You said that you came to give us life and give it to us more abundantly to where literally our lives become overflowing. So Lord, today, let your anointing fall upon me that I'll become that instrument of yours that truly will touch the hearts and lives of many. I ask it in the matchless name of Jesus. And the church said, amen. Amen. Give the Lord an offering of praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, if you need to leave, go ahead. You can leave. Service is over. But if you want to stay, I just want to share with the congregation just for a minute or two. Real briefly, and then you dismiss. I'm only going to just be a minute. I want to give you an update of where things are with our, you know, with our.